Now there it is, Steve. That irregular bulge there. You've got a duodenal ulcer.
Duodenal ulcer?
The commonest type.
It used to be that 10% of everybody in the United States would get an ulcer at some time in their life.
For years, the science on ulcers was settled. Everyone knew that stomach ulcers were caused by too much acid in the stomach. Or were they?
Stomach ulcers, a little hole in the lining of the stomach, can be quite painful. You might get vomiting or stomach pain, and potentially some of them can get quite bad.
Not too long ago, thousands of people with severe stomach ulcers would bleed to death each year.
Because people didn't know the cause of ulcers in the stomach, they said it's caused by too much acid, and the reason you have too much acid is because you're under stress. Nobody bothered to look for another cause.
The story of Barry Marshall and stomach ulcers is a very good example of dogma getting in the way of scientific progress.
Nothing is 100% in medicine. If it's 100%, I don't believe it. They've cheated.
Is science ever settled? Should any conclusions be set in stone? Or should we question everything? Sir Isaac Newton, who helped establish classical mechanics in the late 1600s, said, "If I see further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants." He meant that all he discovered was built upon the discoveries of others. Science is a process that many people contribute to.
We now have hundreds of years of accumulated objective knowledge. Now, some of that will turn out to be wrong. Anything that's settled can be unsettled in liberal science. That's one of its core principles. It's called fallibilism. You might always be wrong.
Everything we consider true was learned through a process of curiosity, observation, experimentation, and doubt. This process is called science.
Science is the most reliable form of knowledge, the one that serves as a paradigm for how we acquire knowledge in other domains. And it works by the urge to explain.
The word science comes along quite late in the story. It's only in the early 19th century does the word scientist start to be used. Before that, natural philosophy was what people described the process of reasoning about the world and trying to understand it.
In 1620, the English philosopher Francis Bacon asserted that all knowledge is derived from observation and experimentation. He described the basis of the scientific method. The basic steps of the scientific method are: make an observation that describes a problem, create a hypothesis, test the hypothesis through experimentation, and draw conclusions. The principles of the scientific method have characterized scientific progress for hundreds of years, and they still do. Barry Marshall and Robin Warren's discovery of the cause and effective cure for stomach ulcers is a perfect example.
When I was much younger, I teamed up with Dr. Warren, who had seen some stomach bacteria on biopsy samples. So normally if people had any kind of stomach problem, you would put the fiber optic endoscope with a little camera on it and look around in the stomach to see if people had an ulcer. But Dr. Warren took some biopsy samples, looked at them under the microscope, and he started seeing these bacteria in the stomach. The weird thing was that all the medical books said bacteria could not live in the stomach because there's so much acid there. So it kills most bacteria. And so we started this journey looking to find out how these bacteria survived in the stomach and what diseases they caused. It was only a year later that when we looked at our data on about 100 people that we could say, you know, there might be something here. Everybody with ulcers has got these bacteria and nobody noticed them before. Maybe the bacteria damages the lining of the stomach and then the acid eats a hole in it. That would make sense.
Discovering the Helicobacter pylori in patients with stomach ulcers could mean changing the way ulcers are treated with antibiotics instead of acid blockers.
In the 80s when we started, everyone with ulcers was being put on these acid blocker tablets. The problem was that they did not cure you. They would just heal the ulcer, and if you stopped taking the treatment, a month later your ulcer would come back. The big pharmaceutical companies could see that it was a gold mine. So by 1987, actually, they were selling $5 billion worth of the main drugs. A friend of mine coined the term acid mafia. So everyone was so focused on acid and acid blockers, they couldn't really admit that they had been on the wrong track. Robin and I had been doing this work for a couple of years. We were starting to get pretty interested. So we submitted our initial research paper to the Australian gastroenterology meeting, and it was rejected. And I did present it a year later, and still nobody believed it. Who are these two doctors there? We've never heard of them. This is strange stuff. I'm going to reject it. And so that happened with us.
It's a real problem with science that in theory it's open to changing its mind. The whole point of science is you change your mind if the facts change. But in practice, science, it behaves in a much more dogmatic fashion than it should. And this has been a constant problem in science over the centuries.
In order to be taken seriously by the scientific community, Marshall and Warren would need to prove that H. pylori bacteria causes ulcers in live animals.
So we had to infect an experimental animal with the bacteria and see if ulcers developed. And we tried it on guinea pigs and pigs and rabbits and rats, no luck. They were immune to these bacteria, so we decided to do a human experiment. And after some discussion with Dr. Warren, we decided that I was going to be the guinea pig. I had to see if a healthy person could be infected. I took the bacteria from a patient who had gastritis or inflammation in the stomach, cultured the bacteria. I think it was a Tuesday morning in July 1984. I drank 1,000 million of these bacteria. So we put the scope down and took some biopsies, and sure enough, I had a very, very thick infection with these bacteria in the stomach. And on the biopsy, we saw exactly the kind of inflammation that we saw in the ulcer patients.
It was that self-experimentation, you know, which was a brave and painful thing to do, that eventually began to persuade the world that he was right.
In 2005, the scientific community that had previously ignored their work honored Marshall and Warren with the Nobel Prize in Medicine.
Against prevailing dogmas, you discovered that one of the most common and important diseases of mankind now can be permanently cured by antibiotics to the benefit of millions of patients.
Finally, could be added, the work that is awarded was performed more than 20 years ago.
20 years, so is that a long time? Too long, but compared to how long ideas, bad ideas hang around, it's the blink of an eye. Science makes its mistakes incredibly quickly. I mean, it throws up millions of hypotheses every day, the vast majority of which will be wrong. And then it finds its mistakes incredibly quickly. It sorts through those haystacks to find those needles, and then circulate those needles through the community, and then do it all again the next day.
So when a scientific discovery seems to fly in the face of settled science, how should that discovery be treated? How do you decide what ideas to ignore, and which deserve a closer look?